after the discourse, there is a question answer session where students can directly question me. It was open interaction. Whenever I interact with youth, it is very spontaneous and hard. Because what type of questions they will ask, neither you know nor I know. I think they themselves may not know. The program started. Suddenly, a young girl, she got up and she asked, "Swamiji, why you became a sannyasi? Is it because of any love barrier? Did you become a swami because of love barrier?" Of course, I cannot lose my temper. That will prove it is the truth. If I lose my temper, that will prove what she said is truth. You are hurt whenever something truth is uttered. See, if somebody says suddenly you have stolen 100 crore rupees, do you feel hurt? No. You know, it is totally out and out lie. But if somebody says you are very short tempered, immediately you feel hurt. It means there is a truth in it. In the world, there is a truth. If there is no truth, you don't feel hurt. I cannot lose my temper. That will prove that what she said is right. And a public stage where thousands are sitting, she put the question. I answered her in a very relaxed way, "No, ma'am, not because of love barrier. I became Swami just because of love success. I am able to love the whole world. I am able to love everybody. I am able to love the whole. That love made me sannyasi. By love failure, you can become only Devadas. Devadas is the character in India who has become popular because of his love failure. Only by love success, you can become Dasa Deva, the divine servant. Love failure can make only Devadas. Love success only can make Devadasa, the divine servant." Totally, it's not because of love failure, it's because of love success I became Swami. What I mean by the word love, what she means by the word love, if you understand these two, then you will understand the whole idea, the today's title, Flirting Divine. What I mean by the word love and what she means by the word love. What is love failure and what is love success? This one understanding can change your whole life, because our actual problem is nothing but love. Either in need or either we are in need of love or we are not ready to give our love. That is the actual problem. That is the root of all our problems. Either we don't want to give or we ask from others. That's a basic problem in everyone's life. Every problem you can see gets in the simple word love. With love, everything becomes divine. Everything goes smooth. The whole life is changed, transformed into heaven. Without that love, the whole thing becomes just hell, dry, dead. With love, everything is understood. Without love, everything is misunderstood. Whatever you do is just misunderstood and misinterpreted. Without love, life becomes just dull, dead, dry, fully dry. With love, whole life becomes smooth, flowing. There is only one thing, understanding our own thing, which can change, which can do a lot in your life. First, let us understand what she means by the word love. What she meant by the word love when she asked. According to the normal understanding, love is an act. According to her understanding, love is nothing but an act. Love can never be an act. If it is an act, after some time you will feel tired. You will feel tired. Naturally, you would like to relax. You would like to rest. You relax only into the hatred. You relax only into the opposite things. That is why all our love creates hatreds. Your love is only one portion of your being. After some time, you will feel a tremendous hate happens to you. It is only the act, it is not a quality. How long you can act? Only for a few hours. Then you will feel tired. Then you will say, enough. Now let me relax into myself. When you relax into yourself naturally, you emit or you show your real face, which is hatred, which is hate, which is violence. The real truth is love is a quality, it is not a quantity. Love is only quality. Love is something which is like a breathing. Do you breathe only once in a while? No. If breathing is an act, you will forget to do at some time. It is not an act, it is your quality. It's your basic quality. The same way, love should become your quality. Love is your quality. A few basic things you need to understand. As long as you think love is a quantity, love is an act, not only you will not be able to love always, you will show only one portion. You will show only your love, only few moments of your life. Love will be like a part-time job. It will be like a part-time job. You will only show only one part of your life. And another thing, you will expect the other. You will expect, you will demand the other to show love continuously on you. When you can't do, you expect the others to do. Third thing, you start possessing the other. Because you have an idea, love is something like a quantity. If he gives his love to somebody else, then what will happen to me? I will not have my share. If she gives her love to somebody else, then what will happen to me? I will not have my portion. So as long as you have an idea, love is a quantity, love is an act. First thing, you will not be able to love continuously. Next thing, you will expect the other to love you continuously. Third thing, you will start possessing the other not to love anybody else. The jealousy and the possessiveness starts. You say, look only at me, don't look at others. Because you think love is an act. If somebody else is also love, you feel something of your thing, something of your portion will be lost. You calculate love also according to your mathematics. But heart does not know your logic. Heart does not understand your mathematics. Heart does not know any of your calculations. You don't understand the dimension of the heart. We understand only the dimension of intellect. we try to measure the product of art, which is love, in the scale of intellect. It's like that. You try to measure the water with a scale. With a scale, you can measure the clothes. A meter scale, you can measure only the clothes. But if you try to measure the water with a scale, you can never be successful. The same way, when you try to measure the love with your head, if you misunderstand, love is a quantity, love is an act, you try to possess the other. Once you understand, love is a quality, love is something to do with their being, love is not an act, it is a very being, then you understand. If he or she loves everybody, only then she or he will love me also. If he or she is not allowed to love somebody else, if he or she is not allowed to show their love to everybody, then how can they love me? How can they show their love to me? The love should be totally unfocused. It should be unfocused on one person. It should be focused on the whole world. As long as the love is focused on one person, you will see it will never be an act of love. It will never be an expression of love. It will be only the act of possessiveness and jealousy, suspicion. These are the byproducts of the focused love. Whenever that love becomes your quality, your being, very being vibrates with the love, your very being vibrates with the flowing consciousness, you will see not only you share your love with the whole world, you don't suspect the other, you don't possess the other, you are not jealous of the other. When you understand love is the quality, the first thing, you start loving always everybody. The next thing, you don't expect the others to react for your love. Third thing, you don't possess or you don't feel jealous. What she says by the word love is an act. What I mean by the word love is a quality. It is nothing to do with act. It is something to do with your quality. If you understand love as an act, you will never, neither you will be also, you will be relaxing, nor you will allow others to relax. You will be continuously keeping watch over the other. You will have continuously your cell phone with you to follow what your husband is doing. And you go, still now, no new missions have discovered that you can have a video meetings. You can have only that voice. If there is some mission, something like that, people would like to have with their husband and wife. You will have a continuous watch over the other. You will have a continuous watch over everybody. Because neither you will be relaxing, nor you will let the other to relax. You are afraid. Continuously you feel insecure. Because according to your mind, according to your understanding, love is an act. You put a blindfold. You see, in India, for hours they put that. It's like a something they will put near the eyes so that the horses will not look here and there. Just like that, you try to put for the other because you think love is an act. Love is never an act. Love is something like a being. Love is something like your quality. There is only one thing. Either you love the whole world or you don't love anybody. That's all. Jesus says, love your enemy. It's very difficult to understand the statement. How can you love your enemy? But if you can't love your enemy, teach you whatever you know by the word love is nothing to do with love. It is just infatuation or the different name of lust. The lust you rename in the name of love. But actual love is something to do with your quality. It has nothing to do with your quantity or an act. When I say flooding with the divine, what is ordinarily called, what is ordinarily understood by the word flooding? It is just a physical lust, a physical need or the physical life. It's nothing to do with the higher being or higher levels, higher aspects of your life. When you ordinarily flirt with the other body, with the other person, you fulfill or you feel that you are fulfilling your physical needs. There are three levels of flirting. First, the flirting with ordinary, the flirting with ordinary life, flirting with ordinary objects, your husband, your wife, your relations, your friends, your house, your car. Don't think you flirt only with the living beings. When some new toy is brought to the child, do you see that how much the child enjoys that toy? Or when a new car is brought, do you see how much you enjoy? You just touch and feel the whole car. You just go for rounds, go for a drive. Even those things are nothing but flirting. When you enjoy something physical, it is flirting with the physical things. When you flirt with the physical body, you give birth to children. You become pregnant in Mooladhara, the lowest level of your energy. You become pregnant in lowest level of your energy and you give birth to children. You reproduce. There is a second level of flirting, second layer of flirting, flirting with art. That's like a, whenever you receive, whenever you fall in love with a great ideology, whenever you fall in love with the great art pieces, if you fall in love with the dance, if you fall in love with the art, if you fall in love with the music, if you fall in love with the poet, then you become pregnant at the level of heart. It's called Hridaya Garbha. Flooding with ordinary is called Bhugarbha. The Garbha which happens to give birth to a child, that's the first level of Garbha. Almost 90% of us know only one level of Garbha, the Bhugarbha. Nothing else. We know how to become pregnant and give birth to a child. The first level, we do not reach the second level at all. Very few fortunate people reach the second level or the second layer of Garbha. That is called Hrid Garbha, Hridaya Garbha. Whenever you fall in love with a great ideology or the great art, great music, I have seen in the Madras, the beach of Madras, the Marina Beach, there is a statue called Jeev Po, one person statue. Jeev Po, he was born here, somewhere in the West. He came to India, he went to Tamil Nadu and read a great book called Tiruvasana. There is a very big book, it is a Stotra San Shiva. He read that book. He simply fell in love with that book and that author. So he went to the India just for a visit. When he went there, he read that book. When he read that book, he was so inspired. He fell in love with that book and the author. He stayed in India, studied Tamil thoroughly and translated that book into English, and he dedicated his whole life, the remaining life, more than 30 years, just spreading that one book. Just spreading that one book, he produced a masterpiece of translation of that book in English. In one of other languages also. In English, he produced a masterpiece. When he fell in love with the great ideology, that book consists of the beautiful stotra from Shiva, the songs in praise of Shiva. And he was a Catholic priest. When he decided to stay in India to translate the book, the church has ordered him, either you come back or you will be thrown out of the priesthood, or you will be thrown out of the monastery. He told, I am resigning from the monastery. He resigned from the monastery. He left everything just for the sake of that one book. He has fallen in love with Manikya Vasara, that great saint, the man who wrote that book. When he fell in love with that book, when he fell in love with that great ideology, when he fell in love with that great art piece, so he conceived the art piece in his heart. He carried the Dhruvasanam in his Hridgarbha and he produced a beautiful masterpiece. It is not even a simple translation. His emotion was attached with it. He produced a great masterpiece. Just like Dhruvasanam in English. Whenever you conceive in the heart, whenever you fall in love with the great art, whenever the Hridgarbha happens to you, you give birth to masterpieces. The Gitanjali. Gitanjali is one of the masterpieces. The paintings of Ravi Verma is something like these masterpieces. The great temples of South India. The great temples of South India. These are the few masterpieces. Why Taj Mahal? Even the Taj Mahal. The Shah Jahan's love is not surely ordinary physical love. It is just went one step above. Just stepped into the zone of art. That is why he could produce such a big masterpiece. So you give birth to the masterpieces when you carry the Hridgarbha. There is a third level of flooding that is called the Jnana Garbha. When you fall in love with the divine, when you start flooding with the divine, when you fall in love with the divine, it cannot be even called as falling in love, it is raising in love. A small story. Once a man fell from the third floor of the building and he has fallen and he has met with a very bad injuries. He was just lying there. On front of one of his friends came and he was about to help. Before that he asked, did it hurt? Did the falling hurt? The man replied, no, the falling has never hurt. Only the stopping has hurt. It's not the falling that hurts, only the stopping that hurts. Just the same way, when you fall in love also, nothing hurts as long as you are floating. You see, if there is nothing to stop, the falling will never hurt. It will be more like a floating. You will be having a good time. You will be just enjoying floating in the air. Only the falling that hurts. Touching the ground that hurts. The same way when you fall in love with somebody, till you touch the ground realities, you don't feel hurt. You feel as if you are floating. That's why whenever people fall in love, they always feel the experience that they are floating. Things feel like that. You are floating as long as you touch the ground. When you touch the ground, then you understand. When you meet with the ground reality, then you understand it is not floating, it is falling. So when you fall in love with ordinary persons in the physical world, it is not. Of course, you know, whenever you fall in love with ordinary persons, it is falling in love. When you fall in love with the divine, it is not falling in love, it is just raising in love. With the divine, you can understand always the levels of love, the levels of your being. When you fall in love with the divine, when you fall in love with the higher concepts, when you fall in love with the meditation or with the spirituality, you have the third level of garbha, the jnana garbha. You conceive in the Sarasvara chakra, then you give birth to yourself. You give birth to yourself. In Sanskrit, it's a beautiful word. Dvija, the person who is reborn. The person who is reborn. Whenever a person takes up the meditation and transforms his life into a new being, he is called as Dvija, newborn or reborn. Whenever you fall in love in ordinary way, you conceive in the Muladhara, you carry the Bhugarbha and give birth to your ordinary person. Whenever you fall in love with the great arts, great masterpieces or great works like Trivasana, you carry the Hridgarbha and you give birth to the masterpieces. Whenever you fall in love with the divine, with the master or with the God, falling in love with God is what is called bhakti. When you use that word, people feel frightened. Bhakti means, oh, I have to do this, I have to do that. No. If you understand that love is an act, you will understand bhakti is also an act. Bhakti is nothing to do with act. Bhakti has nothing to do with your morning prayer or chanting the stotrams. When you fall in love, automatically, when you fall in love with the divine, automatically you chant, automatically you recite. But simple reciting or simple chanting is not the symbol that you are in bhakti. You are in the devotion. When you understand something more than your outer rituals, something more than your outer acts, your heart continuously vibrates with the divine name, continuously feels with the Lord. Today, someone of my devotees came and told me, Swamiji, she is a healer. Swamiji, yesterday somebody came to listen to your discourse, and after listening to your discourse, this moment, she is continuously crying, weeping, 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 out of joy. And the same thing happened to me when I heard you first time. Why? What is happening? Why? I felt as if I am going crazy. I told her. Ramakrishna says in his book, the first teaching of Ramakrishna, there is a book called Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. The first teaching, he says, whenever your eyes pour water, whenever your being feels ecstatic by remembering the Lord's name or by remembering the Master, be sure this is the last Janma for you. Be sure this is the last Janma for you. Be sure the time for your enlightenment has come. The time for your spiritual realization has come. Falling in love with the divine, bhakti means not a simple outer rituals. Just by remembrance, you will feel ecstatic. Something happening in you. You are losing your grounds. You will feel you are floating. You will feel you are being. Something is happening in your being. You are no more an ordinary person. You are no more what you are. You lose, your intellect loses control over your acts. You let go your whole being. You let go your whole body, mind and the spirit. Falling in love with the divine and let go your body and mind and spirit is what is called surrender. When you really fall in love with the God, any form, or with the master, or with the great spiritual ideologies, with the great meditation techniques. You carry your darpa in Sahasrara Chakra. It is called Jnana Darpa. You can see those great meditation techniques in your Sahasrara and carry the Jnana Darpa and give birth to yourself. You are reborn. Dvija. You enter into the state of Nityananda from Mityananda. Mityananda means the bliss which is ephemeral, which is not permanent, which is impermanent. Mityananda, the flooding with ordinary is Mityananda, flooding with the divine is Nityananda. So let you all understand this and enter into meditation. By entering into meditation, let you enter into the divine, let you become Nityananda. Thank you. We will have few minutes for questions. By asking how I am is not going to help you. You understand? How you can become me can help you. You understand? Actually, if I have to answer you straight, I can tell you very clearly, I don't form an opinion. People come and continuously complain about others to me. He is like that, she is like that. Many complaints come to me. But when I tell them, no, if he behaves like that with you, please, you give your reply to him. You give your reply to her. But the same person, you see, there are many of my devotees. One A, one B. The A is very good with me. B is also very good with me. But they don't get along. The A tries to rule over the B. And B tries to rule over the A. A comes and complains me separately. B comes and complains me separately. I tell the B and the A. You see, if the B behaves nicely with you, behave properly. Otherwise, he give you a regular answer. The regular way of treating. But when it comes to me, not only equally, I don't misbehave with them. I behave perfectly all right with them. Because from my personality, I don't form any opinions. I don't form any concept about them. Because human beings should be handled with more compassion. Human beings should be handled with a lot more compassion. As we think, we cannot see when somebody shouts at you, you feel angry towards him. I feel sympathy towards him. Why he shouts? He himself doesn't have peace inside his system. He is not able to accept himself. He vomits out his anger, his vengeance on others. The fellow is shouting. Don't think he will have punishment later on. He is having his punishment. Because he is having his punishment only, he is shouting. People tell me, so many people who shout, will they go to hell? I tell them, no, they are in the hell. There is no need that they should go to hell. They are in the hell. That's why they shout at others. That's why they vomit their anger. That's why they vomit their vengeance. So there is no need for them to go to other hell. When you are shouted, you feel angry. When I am shouted, when they speak ill of me behind the back, I feel sympathy. Oh, it means he is not happy. He is not relaxed. That's why he does all these things. A man is totally relaxed, utterly relaxed within his system, will never go for backfighting, go for politics, go for creating any problem. But when he is not, what he will do? What else he can do? I always tell the people, if the person is not happy with himself, please don't have any relationship with him. Because whatever he does will only come in. Even all his services, people come and offer me. Many times people come and offer me the big amounts. I tell them, as he attended ASP, as he understood our philosophy, as he understood what is meditation, is he accepting the spirituality, is he a meditator? The people around me, they tell me, Swami, why do you bother about all those things? They accept this, let us go for the construction of the ashram. I tell them, no. if he is not happy within himself, within his system, all his doings will be just for the sake of name and fame. Just for the sake of name and fame. He will only create trouble either today or tomorrow. So the relationship with this type of persons will either tomorrow or either today or tomorrow is going to lead only in trouble. A person who is not happy with himself, a person who is not relaxed with himself, will either today or tomorrow create trouble only. Even his child, even his dharma is not going to do any good to the society. It is going to do only bad. So when you are settled within your system, you will see, you will understand. When you accept yourself, then you will understand everybody. Then you will accept everybody. The problem is, we don't accept ourselves. There starts the whole problem. Just sit. When you are alone, just look into your being. You will not have any other thought except guilt and the fear. Except guilt and the fear, there is nothing else. All your thoughts can be traced to that teaching. Either it will be guilt or it will be fear, nothing else. Because you don't have self-respect. You don't accept yourself. Continuously, either you carry guilt or you carry fear. Because you don't accept yourself, you don't accept anybody else. First thing, you don't respect that you are grown. You can grow. The same way, you don't accept the other can grow and the other can change. There is a beautiful saying by a Western philosopher. A beautiful saying. You can never step into the same river twice. You can never step into the same river twice. You understand? Because when you second time step into the river has changed. You can step from the same steps, from the same bathing ghat, but not the same river. If you have entered into the Kaveri from Srirangam, you can enter from the same Srirangam, but not the same Kaveri. Because Kaveri is changing every moment. If you enter into Godavari once, you can enter from the same place, but not the same Godavari. Because the Godavari is changed every moment. Every moment it is changing. You cannot step into the same river twice. I tell you, you cannot step into the same river even once. Because when you put your leg, by the time it reaches the bottom, the water has changed. The water has changed. So you cannot step into the river even once. Every moment things are changing. The same way, just like the river, persons are also changing. Human beings are also changing. Continuously, human beings are changing, growing. We don't respect that others are growing. Because we don't respect that we are growing. I always tell you, if yesterday you are X, today you are X plus. Yesterday you are X, today you are X plus. But you don't feel like that. You don't feel like that. Because you don't respect that you are growing. You don't respect others are also growing. You have the same prejudice. Somebody came and told me, Swamiji, I am going to divorce my wife. I told, why? No, today morning she brought the coffee and kept such a way that coffee has fell on my clothes. Coffee has fallen on my clothes. I told, it's such a simple thing. For this thing, will you go for divorce? He said, no, Swami, you don't know. From the day of my marriage, how much she is torturing me, you don't know. He brings the whole file. He told me, in India, that's a habit. At the time of marriage, they will keep you a small pot inside, one gold ring will be put. Both should put their hand and who picks up the ring, he will win that ring. There is a small game. He says, even at that time, she scratched my hand. With her nail, she scratched my hand. Swami, from that moment, she started torturing me. Until today, it is going on. See the memory of the persons. See the prejudice. see the past which they carry in their life. It's real. We carry such a big COD file. Like actually we act like a police woman. When she does something, when he does something, we don't react to that moment. We have a big file of all their past. We immediately go for reference. Refer and then come on, pass judgment. See, there are two kinds of things. Giving the judgment for the sake of arguments and collecting the arguments for the sake of judgment. Judgment for argument, argument for judgment. In ordinary cases, you have a judgment, you just collect argument for that. You don't go for judgment. You have a judgment, then you collect only arguments to support the judgment. In my case, I have no judgments. Only arguments disable the judgment. Thank you. Your idea about love is only goody-goody. If a person smiles at you, if a person speaks good words at you, if a person behaves at you properly, only then you think he is loving you. A doctor takes a knife and cuts your stomach. What do you say about it? A doctor does a chemotherapy today. Was telling me, Swamiji, in our profession, she is an oncologist. She was telling me, Swamiji, in our profession, when the people come for the chemo or the radiotherapy, they always have a negative feeling towards the doctor. Why? Doctor is not coming for himself. When the doctor does the radiation, or when the doctor does an operation, when he cuts, when he does surgery, what for he does? Out of compassion, out of kindness, surgeries can be done. You will lift the sword, you will lift the knife out of compassion. But from your angle, what do you think? From your angle, what do you feel? You feel only the, what to say, your idea, only the smiling face, the goody words, some sweets. These things only you think as a love. But love can be expressed in so many ways. Love can be expressed in so many ways. Even in the punishment, love can be expressed. It may be, when Janaka does, he has no vengeance. He don't have a personal vengeance. When he does, what he wants is, either he should correct himself or he should not be a disturbance for others. Either to correct himself, you see, when Janaka type of persons give judgment, surely it will be the judgment like a transforming the person. It will not be like a punishing the person. It will be a helpful. It will be a help for transforming the person. If he feels he cannot be transformed, nothing can be done at all, then he has to be removed like a weed. Because the society has to be maintained. The country has to be saved. For that sake, he will be sacrificed. So when Janaka gives punishment, he will not have vengeance. He will not have violence. Because he has no vengeance and violence, he will not have guilt. When ordinary persons give punishment, not only punishment, even when they give love, you will see it will not be a total love. You think people who all smile at you, they all love you? No. Most of the time, the smiles are just to hide their hatred. Most of the time, you smile at other and shake your hands. You will smile at others, but you will never look into their eyes. Have you seen? Most of the time, when people meet, the eye contact never happens. Because when you look into the other's eyes, you can understand what he is thinking. You can understand she is jealous of your sari. You can understand he is jealous of your dress. You can understand he is jealous of your car. That is why we don't look into other's eyes. If you look into the eyes and then shake your hands, then you can be sure he has got some real love. At least we don't have hatred. By gazing into the eyes, looking into the eyes, and very clearly read whether he has got the love or he is just hiding his hatred. So, a person like a Janaka, whose life has become a quality, whose love has become a quality, even if he punishes, he is not coming down from his love. Our normal persons, especially our love, even if you show the loving acts, even if your body language shows you are loving, you never come down from the hatred. You just hide your hatred. It's like a, between two walls, there is a space, there is a gap. That gap is, gap cannot be called as peace. That gap is preparing for the next war. War, and preparing for the next war, and war. The gap cannot be called as a peace. The same way, our body language cannot be called as love. It is the gap between hat and head. It is a gap. You are just getting ready for the next hat, right? That relaxation time only, you call it as a love. Our body language is nothing to do with love. It is hiding the hatred. That's all. It is perfectly alright when you start your religious life. When you start your religious life, it is perfectly alright. Because these are the techniques to make you enter into the religious life. You see, throughout your life, we know only flirting with ordinary. Flirting with ordinary persons. We know only the relationships. We know only relating like a husband, wife, son, mother, father. So we create the same type of relationship among the God and between us and God. In Bhagavata, there is a beautiful word called bhavanas. It means seeing the Krishna as mother, seeing the Krishna as son, seeing the Krishna as beloved, seeing the Krishna as friend, seeing the Krishna as brother. There are so many bhavas. Yashoda saw the Krishna as a son. Radha saw the Krishna as a beloved. Krishna, Arjuna saw the Krishna as a friend. Balram as a brother. Everybody has got their bhavana, their method, way to relate with the divine. When you start, it is perfectly alright. But you should not end there. In Rasleela, Krishna made the gopis mature. He allowed them, he led them to go beyond his form. Have you heard of Rasleela? What we hear about Rasleela is Krishna played with gopis. No, it is not true. Krishna gave them the experience of formless energy. Krishna gave them enlightenment. Krishna made them go beyond his form. Krishna showed that they are God. That is what is actual Rasleela. Krishna helped them to go beyond the relationship. You see, from flirting with ordinary, you are transformed to the flirting with divine. When you flirt with divine, you enter into the formless energy. When you flirt with ordinary, you are with the ordinary forms. The devotion, the bhakti makes you to flirt with the formless energy and end up with the divine form or the divine formless energy. You reach from form to formlessness. For that, if you start with the relationships with the God, perfectly alright, nothing wrong. But don't end up there. Don't stop there. Krishna gave the ultimate enlightenment to Yashoda. Yashoda had always the feeling that Krishna is her son. When he opened the mouth and showed the whole world in the mouth, Krishna showed, no, to look at me as your son in the starting level is perfectly alright. But see who I am. See that I am God. See that I am the whole world. See I am a universe. See I am a cosmic energy. He showed that to her. When he did Rasleela, he showed the same thing to the gopis. When he gave the Gita and gave the Vishwarupa Darshan to Arjuna, he showed the same thing to Arjuna. Arjuna says, oh God, I called you as A Krishna, A Yadava. I called you by your surname. I called you by your family name. I called you as my friend. I played with you. Oh, how much, what big mistake I did. What great papa I did. I thought you are my friend. Now I understand you are God. Krishna says, don't worry. To start, if you feel I am your friend, nothing wrong. But When you yell, you should understand, I am divine, I am God. People come and tell me, many people come and tell me, Swamiji, your age is my son's age. I feel more or less like you are my son. I always tell them, perfectly alright. Carry on. When you start as a son, perfectly alright, carry on. If you feel like a son, nothing wrong. But when you end, you should not end with the same mood. When you end, understand the divinity, understand the spirituality, understand the energy totally, understand the greatness and enter into the Ananda. No prarabdha karma. It is simple conscious decision. The three words yesterday I told you. It is not only meditation. The three parts of meditation, three mechanisms of meditation. The first thing, listening, shravana. Second thing, manana, contemplating. Third thing, nididhyasana, expressing. Listen these great truths. By the way, our satsanga, are we reading the great books written by enlightened masters? Please don't read any book which is not done by written by enlightened master. Read only the books done by enlightened persons, because they will not only have the philosophy, they will have the techniques to reach that state. When you read the books of unenlightened persons, they will land you only in the more confusion. You are already confused. You will land only in the more confusion. When you read the books of enlightened persons, the shravana happens. You are listening. Those great ideas enter into you. The first step of alchemy starts happening. Then the next step, when the contemplation, again and again remembering, again and again recollecting, when the contemplation happens, the manana, when that happens, you allow the alchemy process, you encourage the alchemy process, you welcome the alchemy process to happen in you. Third thing, express it. Put little bit of effort, conscious effort, to put those ideas into your practice. See, in yoga they say, today if you bend for 6 inch, tomorrow 6 and a half. By half inch, your back is not going to break. But when you do the yoga asanas, today 6 inch, today just 6 and a half inch. Tomorrow, just 7, half inch. Put one by one, little by little of effort. Then you will see, simply the whole life transforms. These are the different ways. Listening, again and again and again. Not once or twice. Listening again and again and again. Somebody asked Buddha, last 40 years, Buddha is the master who lived after enlightenment for a long time. Very few live after enlightenment for a long time. Buddha is the one person. He gave discourses for 40 years. Somebody asked, for 40 years you are telling the same thing. Why? He says, even with 40 years of preaching, there are only few who have become awakened. So again and again and again you need to listen. Otherwise you will forget. So again and again when you listen, the shravan, the alchemy starts happening. When you meditate, the manan, the contemplation happens. When you start living, express it, the nididhyasana happens. Thank you.